arms, I'm all lost in your arms, I'm all lost in your arms to share. I probably will do some shows around. I'm having an act together now. Probably doing a couple of duets with Lavern. Where do former impersonators go to when they retire? They come to Las Vegas. Why not?
My late mom, Tina, will say to me, you know, if you're going to retire someday, you should try to be in Las Vegas, which is supposed to be the center of entertainment, especially after Finocchio's closed. So we decided to come to Las Vegas, and I've been here now about 7 years. And I have done a few shows here for the Clark County Libraries, doing my Judy Garland act, and also my other bilingual act called Boy Chick.
I was a boy soprano in my youth, and then in the choir, I figured in high school, they wanted to sing lower. And I did. So I was always called a split voice singer because I could sing in both voices. So that's what was the beginning of the persona of Lavern, who was the breadwinner, I should say, because that's my career.
I have been performing since 1965 when I was a teenager in Chicago. I got written in 4 books because of my Judy Garland act.
I would start it in the high voice and then switch to the low voice in the middle of the song. And the audience would get, you know, kind of shake up and applaud. And of course, I'd drag all the time. Probably the main thing that you have to do is pad for the bust line and the hips to give the illusion of a shape underneath your those beautiful gowns that I wore so many of.
The show was known around the whole country and abroad because of the us performing live. Of course, people came to the show because they wanted to see a boy drag. But then, once the shock was over, then they would say, wow, is that his voice? Or they would say sometimes, oh no, I'm sure they're lip syncing. These are some of the famous movie stars that I got to meet during my lifetime, like Tony Curtis, Liberace.
Finocchio's, there probably will be no place like that again.
And it just went on for 63 years. I feel sometimes dead because those people gave me a lot of oomph in my life.
Finocchio's closed in 1999. Now I had left in 82. I think I had the longest run at Finocchio's, 26 years. In one club is wrong time.
You'll find that life is still worthwhile if you just
smile. Theatre presents a retrospective interview with the last two living Finocchio Club female impersonators and singing stars, David D'Alba and Paul Lavern Cummings. David and Paul will not perform in drag. Gosh, I hate that word, because they're really entertainers. But instead, They will answer questions about their years as icons at the famed San Francisco nightclub. Finocchio's was located on Broadway. The club opened as a speakeasy in the 1930s. In the 1940s, owner Joe Finocchio came up with a revolutionary entertainment idea. He would have men dress as women and perform live on stage with a backup band. Lip-syncing was not allowed. The concept made Finocchio's the place to be in San Francisco for 63 years. I first discovered Finocchio's as a teenager. I was interested and amazed after reading stories in the San Francisco newspapers about the female impersonators who would perform to standing room only audiences every night. Two of my favorites were David D'Alba and Paul Lavern Cummings, and honestly, I fell in love with both of them. I could never attend a show of Finocchio's, as first, I was too young, and second, our family moved out of the area. However, I have seen a number of the film clips you will see tonight. I am still amazed at the ability of the performers, including David and Lavern, Carol Wallace, Elton Paris, and the great Lucian, just to name a few. About a year ago, I stumbled on a website which led me to David and Paul. Since then, we have become dear friends. In fact, the earrings I'm wearing tonight were worn by Paul on the Finocchio stage. I'm thrilled to own a little piece of history from my American idol. Thank you, Paul. Recently, David and Paul were inducted into the TG Forum's Gallery of Grace, and tonight, during the show, they will receive their awards. Congratulations. Now sit back and relax and enjoy a ride through history. Please welcome to the Onyx Theatre stage, David D'Alba and Paul Lavern Cummings.
Okay, you thought we weren't getting out in a wheelchair. We're supposed to be the two living legends, the American legend and the Cuban legend. Desi Arnaz Sr. says, David, why are you going to do the show? What am I doing? Is that a bad spirit? Is that Desi telling me something? Oh, darling. Well, here's what happens. I thought, we're going to conduct an interview. Who better than myself? I know this gentleman as long as I know my partner, Paul Reiner, since 1970. We worked together, so it's a long time. And I thought he would be more at ease with the questions. Of course, I have been a celebrity interviewer for many years now for my website, which has won many awards. So I thought, well, I can emcee the show, because at Finocchio's, when Carol Wallace was sick, I was asked to emcee the show. Even with my Cuban accent, I did it. And I was a celebrity interviewer for many years for my website. I got to interview, before he died, the great Buddy Ebsen, Robert Goulet, the great female impersonator from England, Danny LaRue, Ricky Renee, Jim Bailey, and the list goes on and on and on. So I thought, well, I can do the interview, but I don't want the questions to be biased, because I like myself too much and I like him too much. So, if you don't like yourself, who's going to like you? So I found out that, so I contacted Carolyn, who is the book author. I said, will you please write 9 questions for him and 9 for me? And she faxed them 2 days ago, and I refused to look at them because I didn't want to learn what she, so I just sort of browsed quickly. I said, no, I'll do them. So we're going to ask some questions for him. And because hard times calls for harsh measures, and I couldn't get Norman Clark to interview this, so I'll ask myself the questions that Carolyn sent me. Well, you know, the economy is bad, dear. So, and later on in the show, a surprise, he's going to sing. He hasn't performed since 1982, when he retired from the office. I kept going, because he retired from driving. I kept going, I said, oh no, I cannot retire. I keep going until I drop dead as an old lady with a red hat. Oh, the red hat is Karen Darling! Thank God for it. Thank you! The Queen Mary. Oh, my dear, I have a senior moment. Anyway, they always follow me around. I said, they should have a boy too with a red hat, because the YMCA used to be for boys, now they have YMCA and YWCA together. So anyway, I should do my quiz. Oh my God. And this is being videotaped, and I was told that some of the transgender forums in different parts of the world would like us to make copies so they can sell this show to people in Germany, Africa. I get emails from all over the world from people who used to go to Finocchio's, and they send me things about him, about me, saying, I would like to come by leaving Africa. It's very difficult to come. But there's a person who's coming who came today all the way from Phoenix. And next week, yes, it's true, darling, the lovely Marianne Milano, who saw Lavern, Cummings, and Finocchio in 1968, she came especially to see you. Yeah. And for my show in September, which I'll plug later, there is a lady, I feel so honored, she's flying from Holland. She bought 5 tickets, she said, I'm going to fly from Holland, come to Las Vegas on Saturday night, see your show on Sunday, and go back home. I said, my God, you know. Anyway, let me see what in the world. I hate meeting, darling. I should thank all these people, otherwise I forget, and they'll crucify me, the media. Yeah, they'll write things. I should say quickly, I won't do like the people do at the awards, because they go on, they think that the dogs and the horses and the music goes on. Oh, I forgot my agent. No, I'm going to go quickly. Media publicity credits to Angela Gardner from the TG Forum, to Barbara Jean Jason, I hope she's here, because she wrote an article about me in her magazine, the great Norman Clark, who has been advertising, Christy Jordan, who wrote a very nice article, Monty Rock III, and Frank Furtado, and then creating some of the DVDs you see for the show. Carolyn Olson, who is unfortunately in Sacramento, she couldn't come. My friend from Cuba, Agustin Blasquez, and an ex-co-worker friend of ours, Kenny Stewart from Finocchio, who's supposed to be here tonight. And he was the only boy dressed as a boy in the show. And he told me, David, before the show is over, do your takeoff on Joe Finocchio. I say yes, and I'll do the impression of Mrs. Finocchio, but Mrs. Finocchio's voice is very hard to do because she sounded to me like Faint and Away when she was doing Mommy Dearest, Joan Crawford. But Mr. Finocchio's voice is charming, so I'll do that later before. You remind me, Marianne, in case I forget. Now I got through with all this, thank you. Now, let's go to the questions. And then we play some more DVDs of our past. Laverne, this is for, he's, all the stage performance as a drag performer was Lavern, so he goes by the name of Paul now. But I don't want to get confused.
Lavern is my middle name.
I know the middle name, but you always, use that for Finocchio. In fact, his stage introduction was the form and grace and lovely face of our sophisticated song, the incomparable Mr. Lavern Cummings. That was his introduction. And this is me. I wasn't chopped liver either. Yes. In 1969, when I did Judy Garland at the Aragon Ballroom in Chicago, and I got to meet that real Judy Garland 8 months before she died, and she said to me, do you like me that much? I said, yes, I do impersonations of you. And she said, I would like to catch your show tomorrow, but I have to go on tour. And then my mom was in front of me, and she said to me, who is this lovely lady? And she said, I said, this is my mom, Tila. And now Judy Garland became Dorothy Gale of Kansas. And she said, I wish I had a mother like you have. She walked away, and 9 months passed by, and she passed away. Oh my God. That's why I brought my Kleenex. I hope I don't ruin my neck of crying. So, and since that time, I have been doing Judy in tribute to her. Now, after a little bit of trivia for Paul, but Carolyn Olson says, how did you get your start as a female impersonator?
Well, I was living in Orange County in Southern California, and I moved to Los Angeles after I turned 21, and didn't know what I wanted to do with my career or my life at that time, and I took some odd and end jobs there for a while, and then one evening some friends that I had gone out to dinner with decided to take me to an impersonation show called Continental out on Santa Monica Boulevard, and not telling me that they had an amateur show at that particular night, and they knew that I sang in a high voice, and they encouraged me to enter the contest, and I did, and after the show, the management offered me a job, and that was the beginning. A little bio on myself as far as my voice. In my teen years in junior high, I was a boy soprano, and then when I took choir in high school, they wanted me to sing lower, both voices, which I was to use later on in my career. But back to the start, after I was at the Club Continental just for a few months, I had an offer to join a traveling show, which was appearing in Minneapolis at that time, called the Jewel Box Review. Now, the Jewel Box was a big production show, and there were many great performers. Now, they had been there all summer in Minneapolis, and they had brought in more people, and I was one of the new people, because the original show that had opened there in the spring had already gone back to Florida, because Florida was the home base, Miami, for the Jewel Box Review back in those days. And I joined the show there, and we had a few months run, and then the show closed. And a few of us were asked to join the review that was already in progress in Miami. And I was one of the lucky ones chosen. And that began my career with the Jewel Box Review. And they liked me very much. They saw potential, and they started building me to work with the chorus boys and everything. There was the star, of course, the star of the show at that time was Jackie May. And then later on came in T.C. Jones. I don't know if any of you are familiar with these names. And Lynn Carter came in later. And all of those great performers that worked with the Jewel Box. And then we had a great, we had a big opening number. The middle production number, which was usually in black light, and then we had a big finale. I was a showgirl at the beginning in all of these, and all the chorus boys had to be at least 6 foot tall, because you get us in high heels and we're up there. I'm only 5'8", but then that adds a few inches, and it made us look better to have the boys taller, of course.
What I should mention, and I don't mean this harshly, however, yes, I have great respect for anybody who performs and does it from the heart, but there's a great difference. People who, in the old days, we used to call the word pantomime, now they say lip sync. We had to sing live.
Always.
Always. If we had a good voice or with a fever, call or whatever, and we had to project with our voices. We didn't have that wonderful feeling to just put a record of Judy or Liza and just mimic. Well, I could have, when I think of all the thousands of dollars I lost in music, and he too, thousands of dollars for arrangements. We had to do at Finocchio's 4 shows a night, 3 arrangements per show, and those. At that time, they charged like 160, 180 per arrangement. I could have bought a vinyl record for $10, and I could have pantomimed to Over the Rainbow and Liza's New York, New York Forever, and I would have saved a lot of money, but we didn't. So that's why I wanted this show to take place, so the people who have passed away, and there's so many, I wish I could just bring back here Lou Chanel, Tom Paris, Bobby De Castro. I'm so happy to do this show because everybody's dying on me. He's the only one alive with me. And if these people were here, I want you to know how much, how hard they work on the stage. And in a way, maybe they can see us. I should do something funny about Mr. Finocchio now, so I don't cry here. Oh, Mr. Finocchio. Mr. Finocchio. Well, Mr. Finocchio.
What a great old
girl. Yeah, well,
yes.
Yeah, Mr. Finocchio, you know, he was a very nice gentleman.
Old school.
He was dressed in a suit, you know, with a white mustache, balding, with short hair, and he would be standing, and his wife would be at the cash register taking the money. The great Mr. Finocchio. And Mr. Finocchio would be here, you know, making your party, and he would take them. Nobody, if the boys who want to get a job in drag would know that, they would have flocked them more often. So he would come in, you know, and he would take. But that was a side of him that was very stern. I was sort of afraid of him because he was always so stern. You know, he wasn't the type of warm like Gina Lollobrigida or Sophia Loren. So when he would get mad, like now, I can see in heaven saying, I don't know whether this is Boya, Lavern, coming at a David Alba, working out of a drag. What do they think they're doing? My club was made for the boy to work in the drag, and that's why we made a lot of money. Now, if my club was open and the word get out that Lavern coming and David Alba are working out of drag, then the whole show, they want to come out dressed as boys, and my show will go down in the dumps. Well, that's the way he sounded. Well, now I don't have to cry. Now I can laugh in between tears. Another one for Mr. Cummings. I think I want, after this question, I would love Jake, a wonderful technician, to play the tribute that Katie Stewart made of Lavern Cummings images, still photos and photos taken at the Duo Box review with his own hair, and he's actually combing his hair, and then later on when he was a Finocchio wearing a wig. So here's the second question for Mr. Cummings, and then after that, please play the DVD. Did you have someone who helped you develop your female performing style?
Not really, just someone. I would watch movie stars, watch women, the way they would walk, move. You know, that's my conception of impersonation. I mean, they say drag queen today, but it was known as just female impersonator, and that's what it means. Impersonate female, you know, look like, move like, sound like. And with my soprano voice, which I was fortunate to have for 33 years, which was unusual, as they always said that a man's voice is like a head voice, you know, a lot of tenors or baritones would go into a high register, a head voice, or a falsetto. And I never liked the term falsetto because it was real to me, and I didn't have, you know, that split voice thing until really later on. But I was only with the Jewel Box about 5 or 6 years, and then I went on to Finocchio's for my longest run of 26 years. So.
We don't want to create a silhouette. We are the Proud Boys, P-R-O-P.
Thank you.
I said, after they see these pictures, they'll say, what happened? I said, well, let me see here. Is everybody 18 anymore? No? So we are in the same boat.
Time waits for no one.
I know that. Well, you know, consider I'm between 40 and death, I can still create an illusion. Oh, far away. Oh, no, no, this far. Now I look pretty far. They said, don't get too close. I said, listen, dear. He said, if you get too close, you'll see lines, and they see your age. I said, yes, but then you show warmth like Judy Garland had. I don't want to be the Marlene Dietrich. You know, she was darling, but she was straight at you. I said, I'm a darling. And then forget, she did a show at the Circle Star. There were some hippies making noises. And she says, darling, the show is here, not there. Oh my God. Can you imagine? If they have cellular phones, she will go crazy nowadays. I better do a quiz for me. After all, I'm an orphan, so I better get a piece of the pie too. Let me see.
Kenny, if you're here, thank you for that.
Kenny, what's Kenny?
Back here.
What? Oh, he's
welcome.
Can
you
put a knife on him?
He's no, way back here.
Oh, no, he's too shy. He doesn't want to make a comeback. Okay, it's okay. Kenny's too, our wonderful ventriloquist. Davis questions, over. Carolyn, she says, how did you get in the art of female impersonation? Well, there we go again. In 1965, I was a teenager once or twice. I was living in Chicago, just came from Cuba. Thank God I came from Cuba. My mom was alerted about that damn Castro who took the country, and he would kill people, and he would try to kill gay boys just because they were gay, and thanks to her, I got out on time. Anyway, so there I am in Chicago, a teenager, and I met this very famous hairdresser in Chicago by now, so many years. I forgot his name, forgive me. Anyway, he says, I'd like to make you up for a Halloween drag ball at the Aragon Ballroom. That one. And he took me to his house, and he made me up. And he says, you look like Judy Garland. I said, can you sing? I said, well, yes, I can sing, but nobody can sing like Judy. But I refuse to lip sync. He says, you know what you do? Just put a record on and sing over her voice like a duet. So I got dressed in that costume. My grandmother, Maria, made it. It was taken from the movie Judy was supposed to do called Valley of the Dolls. And there was a replica. So I went and I did this, actually, 6 months after Judy died. And so that's how I started in Chicago. I played in different nightclubs. And then they said to me, you should go to San Francisco. The funniest, thank God I did. And Finocchio was there, so, and that's when slowly the doors opened, because being also a well-known hairdresser, I used to work with wigs and things like that. I got my foot at the door at Finocchio's by saying to Miss Finocchio was a hairdresser, so I got to go backstage. And I got to meet several of the boys in the show. He had his own hairdresser. I only did his wig once, but I did Carol Wallace's wig and Elton Paris's and the Great Lucian and the list, René De Carlo, and the list goes on and on. And then when they found out that David could perform, then they got a word that, oh, Mr. Finocchio, oh, to his wife, oh, listen, Eva, there's a boy from Cuba, and he sings in Spanish, you know. Lavern is singing in English, but he can sing in Spanish. And when we have a tour buses, you know, from Colombia, from Cuba, Puerto Rico, David will fit the bill. So here, David became the bilingual singer, singing Spanish and English. Okay, he did 2 questions, second question, then we play more activities. If I don't keep the order, I'll forget this here. And I say, oh my God. Tell us about your singing idols, Olga and Tony and Judy Garland, and did you ever meet them in person? Well, Olga and Tony were a very famous Cuban husband and wife team. And Olga Choren, Chorens, her voice was like a Barbra Streisand in this country. And when I was a little boy, my parents would take me from my province of Camagüey to Havana to see Olga and Tony saying on TV and on the radio. And I established a little rapport. They have so many little boys that came to the TV show, but somehow I am like glue. Some people like me and some people don't like me. And Olga seemed to like me, and that image stayed in her mind. And about 1974, I went to Miami, and they were playing, and I took my mom and my partner, Paul, to see Olga and Tony. And I said, Olga, here's a picture of me taken in Cuba outside the CMQ TV. I said, you have so many boys that came to see you there. She says to her husband, Tony, honey, come here. I do remember this boy. Remember, this is the boy from Come Away. I said, you remember me? I said, well, by the way, you know, I sing now professionally. Well, why don't you do a song? I said, I don't have my drag costume. She said, well, sing as a boy. So I got to sing for them. She said, next year you come, and I want you to get in drag. Well, imagine to have Olga Torres, my idol, I would do one of her songs tonight in Spanish. She sat there, and she says, I want to hear a big star. And this little boy, not famous, she says, I want to see David because he does a better impersonation of myself than myself. I said, what do you mean? I said, well, I love you so much that when I see you, I sort of capture you, and you take yourself for granted. I know how you move your hands and your eyes and your hair. So we became friends throughout the years. Now, of course, I told her how I met Judy Garland earlier in Chicago, so that answers that question. So, what a wonderful segue. Maybe you can play my tribute to Judy Garland, which was taped about 4 years ago here at the Winchester Theater. And that bring me up to date performing in Las Vegas. We better get up away from this.
Yes. We are now on the strip, so I better kill time while he finds the tape. We used to about Finocchio all the time. They threw that enough and they said, oh,
let's bring to the stage the warm and charming personality of David the Alba, the Cuban legend.
Thank you.
I became really old because just because, oh, I used to do, and then, oh, I have to tell you a story. I wait, you have to do some kind of a little bit here. And this is a real story. So when some of these performers who work on the street, they get a big head, watch it. This happened to two famous stars, and it's not funny. So you better keep your feet on the ground. In the early 1990s, in Los Angeles, at a grocery store, there was this lady with a baby screaming, and this older black lady, very sweet, goes in front of her and says, "May I sing to your child a lullaby?" She said, "Sure, if you want." So the lady sang. She said, "Thank you," and left. And another lady came rushing and said to the lady with the baby, "Do you know who she was?" She says, "No." That was Ella Fitzgerald. And the woman didn't know who she was. Another story. So that's why a lot of these people, they better put their, because to the biggest names, this famous star is in Denmark, and she went to a discotheque. For the young ones, a discotheque is a place where people used to dance. They don't have that anymore anyway. How come we have anybody under 21 here anyway? Otherwise, I'd be in trouble here. They said, "What in the hell is he doing?" So this lovely icon from this country was asked by this handsome young man to dance. And when they got through, he took her back to the seat. And this lady with a wonderful sense of humor, you know, she said to her people at the table, "Can you imagine? He doesn't know who I am." That was Judy Garland. Then she says, "Oh, Mercury, to make it worse, I go to the airport and a lady recognizes me. She says, 'Honey, this is Dorothy.'" And the lady said, "But the daughter looks so disappointed. I wish I could just pick out from my purse two pigtails and put it on." Because the girl says, "Judy Garland, what you are, you know, she didn't look like Dorothy." So it's to show you that. So I didn't want to go into oblivion. So when I had a chance to put the show together, I said, "I'm going to bring my friend back so he can do a comeback and sing tonight, and I can enjoy him, because every time I do a tribute, everybody's dead. So I want to do a tribute when they're alive. That's why you should sponsor. And when I do a show next month about my Finocchio memoirs, which I'm going to sing some of the beautiful songs I sang in French, Spanish, and English, different DVDs of his, and other performers, please come so I won't have an empty theater, because it's a very wonderful show. I think you're going to enjoy it."
Yes, you must tell them the date.
Oh, yes. When they go outside, September.
September the
18th. And Jake, who's a wife of 10, he said, I said, when they go out, you grab them. Make them buy a ticket. At least I know we'll have a nice crowd. So if you like me, just get your ticket. You know,
we have a special gift for you and Mr. Cummings, David. Oh. Would you like to see what that is?
Yes.
All right.
Well, I need a gift. I haven't had a gift for a long time. What happened? Boy, his birthday was last week, and I sang for him a song in Spanish.
Well, just sit tight and we'll see what it is.
Okay? Oh my God, I've been surprised for a long time.
And to think that I am in my third act of life.
I am 2.5.
I hope you're enjoying the show. Transgender Forum is a website that honors, celebrates, and provides information about every form of transgender behavior. You can find it on the internet at www.tgforum.com. Anyone who identifies with any part of transgender spectrum is welcome at TG Forum. Part of the TG Forum mission is to teach transgender history and pass it on to the younger generations. To that end, TG Forum has established the Gallery of Grace to showcase the top female impersonators of the 20th century. Two of those greats stand upon the stage tonight. Although they were both inducted into the Gallery of Grace several years ago, TG Forum has asked me to recognize their induction into the gallery. On behalf of TG Forum, I'm honored to present these two certificates to two of the greats, David D'Alba and Paul Lavern Cummings. Congratulations.
Like Alfred Hitchcock, when he got his Oscar, he just went like this. He was afraid somebody was going to steal it. Thank you, Angela Gardner.
Yes.
Now we can hang things up so that young ones could say, who is Lavern, who is Davis? And then go to the internet, honey. We are all over YouTube. I better put this, you know, why don't you change, sweetie, into your costume for your song? I can hardly wait to see him perform. I'll put this on top of the piano. Change, and I'll kill some time, which is not hard to do with Slavic. Don't fall down here. Can you see there? We don't have anybody to help us. No, come this way here. We need some help here. One more. One step. That's it. Well, I should see the Slavic people. Betty, she has followed me everywhere I go in my life. Thank God for Betty and her lovely sister, Arigato. For coming, I already say hello to you, and to you, and the lovely red hatters. What can I do with these lovely reds? Keep talking to the chapters, there's so many chapters, let them come here.
I'm gonna put it back on the website.
Yes, but people forget, they tell me, oh, well, if you do a show on Sunday, David, you have to hurry up because we have to go to church in the morning, or we have to go to the temple at 6 o'clock, but if you do it on Saturday, we have to go to the synagogue. I said, well, what do I do then? If I do it on Monday, no, we work in the casino. I said, what in the hell am I going to do? You do a show at 10 p.m., the old people don't want to go out. If you do it at 3 o'clock, they're busy barbecuing. So what am I going to do? So just show up. 5 o'clock is not too bad. 4 o'clock then. Maybe he's, oh, I have to drink some water. I don't want to drink some, because if I drink too much, I have to go to the pee-pee room. Well, and we don't have any dancing boys naked to film into the streets for me. Oh, Mr. Finocchio, if you could say, what are these boys are doing now? He's coming out dressed as a man. I said, Mr. Finocchio. A friend of mine, she says to me, if you don't get in drag, how are you going to sing these beautiful songs tonight? New songs, I hope I remember. I said, well, honey, the way I look tonight, I look more like what they call a lipstick lesbian nowadays. So I can get away singing a female song. Is he ready? Are you ready, dear one? You see, we haven't rehearsed very much. No, he's there. Okay, I don't know what's going on. You'll come out. That's what happened at Finocchio's. And Carol Wallace, thank God. Oh, he is there. Let me get away. This is... Mike, so he had the stage.
Really? Hi, everybody. You know I'm totally bad. I used to be on top. But I don't let that get me down. I'm a proud man. Let me tell you about it. I once lived the life of a millionaire, spending my money, I didn't care, taking my friends out for a good time, buying champagne, gin, wine, but just as soon as my dough got low, I couldn't find a friend any place I'd go. But if I ever get my hands on a dollar sometime, I'm gonna squeeze it till we go give birth to a dime. Nobody knows you when you're down and out. In your pocket, not one penny, and your friends haven't any. But as soon as you get on your feet again, everybody is your long lost friend. It's mighty strange, without a doubt, but nobody knows you when you're down and out. Cause you're nobody till somebody loves you. You're nobody became. You may possess the world and its gold. The gold won't bring you happiness when you're growing old. The world still is the same. You'll never change it. As sure as the stars shine above, you're nobody till somebody loves you. So find yourself somebody. Everybody needs somebody.
To go way back, we dug back in the archives for a song that I used to do as Lavern, and I had recorded a few things in a studio. A lot of things are recorded in the club at Finocchio's, but there was background noise and they weren't as clear, you know, and as good. But we found this song from a film. Clue? Well, film. Way back, I believe it was in the 50s, 58. It's from a film called Houseboat, which starred Cary Grant, Sylvia Loren. And it was kind of an ongoing theme. And so we'd like to present it to you at this time, as it was not set up yet, is it? There it is! You're near, that moment's here. I'm almost in your arms. Tonight, the mood is right. I'm almost in your arms. Once I, one word and I will rush to your embrace. Say that's a word, sigh, that's a sigh, and with all my heart to your arms I'll fly and scream. How we are changed by things that seem so small. One look can write a book. One touch can say it all. We've known those nights alone, and now we've found our way. I'm almost in your arms, almost in your arms, nearly in your arms. I'm almost in your arms. Thank you. We thank you. You dug that one back, but
It was a great tour. You know, David has always been a good friend. We've known each other for many years. As he mentioned earlier, my birthday last week, we were talking on the phone, and he sang happy birthday in Spanish. And it was very touching. But be that as it may, did you know that David is bilingual? He does songs in many languages and has had a great career and still going. A lot of impersonators, of course, have passed on, and those that are still with us and active are doing a great job. Ladies and gentlemen, my friend, David D'Alba.
Am I having joyous? This Cuban song for my friend Jessica, wherever you are. And to those of you who speak Spanish, I dedicate this song to you. My friend Olga Cherenz, the buster here in Cuba. I wish we could have a curtain, which is. Ya me cansé de tanto llanto y sufrimiento y ya no ves como sin ti sigo viviendo. Ya no tendrás que por mi amor seguir fingiendo. Puedes robar a otra infeliz su sentimiento. En mí no habrá ya para ti ni un pensamiento de pena, de rencor. Pero cuánto lo siento. Song is in English, I am sorry. Ya te borré del corazón, ya para siempre. Ya te borré de mi existir completamente. Ya me cansé de tanto llanto y sufrimiento. Y ya lo ves como sin ti sigo viviendo. Ya no tendrás que por mi amor seguir fingiendo. Puedes robar a otra infeliz su sentimiento. En mí no habrá ya para ti ni un pensamiento de pena o de rencor. Pero cuánto, cuánto lo siento. Oh, my God, I drink some water here. Oh, I'm not 30 anymore. Now, for the playmate, I hope I remember the... I've never done this song publicly. I hope I remember the words. If not, we can take another take. Maine singing to her little son about the sun. Where's the boy with a bugle? My little love, who was always my big romance. Where's that boy with a bugle? And why did I never buy him those damn long pants? Did he need a stronger hand? Did I give too much at the moment when he needed me? Did I ever turn away? Would I be there when he called? If he walked into my life today, were his days a little dull? Were his nights a little wild? Did I overstress my plan? Did I stress the man and forget the child? But there must have been a million things that my heart forgot to say. Would I be there when he called, if he walked into my life today? Should I blame the times I pampered him, or blame the times I bossed him? What a shame I never really found a boy before I lost him. Were the years a little fast? Was this world a little free? Was there too much of a crowd, all too lush and loud, and not enough of me? So I'll ask myself, my whole life long, what went wrong along the way? If he walked into my life today, if that boy with a bugle walked into my life. are you? And I was better when I was 30, dear. And I look prettier. I look so hard.
Fabulous.
I look fine. You look very fine. And my voice. I bet a lot of money for some shots on my face this month to look nice with hormones, just a few fillers so I look young on the stage. For you people, otherwise they're going to say, oh my God, how bad I look. And I say, no. $1,000. Oh my God. Where's my friend? Paul. Oh, I lost him. Oh my God. Oh, I do a question for myself then.
Okay.
You know, then the question, okay. Oh my God, now I'm going to cry again. Oh my God. What influence did your mother Tina bring in your life? Oh boy. She. Oh my God. Now I got. Now that's the end of the makeup. Well. My mom passed away 3.5 years ago, and people keep telling me, David must be a masochist because you inflict pain on yourself because we all have to die. You're not the only orphan. I said, I know I'm not the only orphan, but not all the kids are as close to their mothers like I was. When I was a little boy in Cuba, my mother had her beautiful wedding dress cut short, gown, and she would play that beautiful piano. She has 6 degrees, and I would sit next to her. Then in San Francisco later on, when she retired from her teaching position, she joined my beauty salon in the daytime when I worked at the Finocchio's, and she was my secretary, and we went to play a documentary at that shop taped in 1982 of me doing hair and my mom there. So, but we asked, out of 10 things, we get along with 8. We blend them. We like Judy Garland. We like my friends Olga Cherez. We love pets. We like dogs. We like birds. If a bird or a dog was sick, they would call us Tila, David, and we would go and rescue them. We love plants. We love real estate. And we talk about the spiritual world. We have so many things in common. The umbilical cord never broke until she died. And the ending, I keep saying it to people, I hope I never end like this. When the day she got sick at the hospital, that should remain nameless. I guess I had a male nurse who was homophobic or inhuman, but he says to me, Mr. Garcia, my real name is Eric Garcia, H-E-R-I Garcia. You should be very lucky that your mother has lasted you this long because we have had people much younger than her die in the hospital here. Yeah, listen to this here. So he says to me, so, there's nothing much we can do for her unless you want me to hit her ribs and break her ribs. I said, no. He said, so we're just going to escort her to a room there, and you look at the monitor, and when the line goes flat, means she's dead. Can you imagine why I have gone through 3 years? This haunts me every night. So she went to a coma, they were making mistakes, and doing all kinds of things, she went to a coma, and I was holding her hand, and the nurse there, she said, she's not holding your hand, you're holding her hand. I said, yes, I know, dear, but I want to be here. But my mother always told me, don't look at me dead. I want you to remember. So 5 minutes before she passed away, I left, so I could remember her. But it's hard for me to forget. People say, go on. Well, I'm going on. I'm singing, I'm dancing, but it doesn't get easier. There's an old saying in the theater that says, when you are in pain and the lights hit you, the pain goes away. It's a stinking lie. So let's play. So the interest of my mom, my father was wonderful too. He dressed impeccably, like Cary Grant, always beautifully dressed. And to the end of her days, I did my mother's makeup, her hair, her nails, her pedicure, and she died looking pretty. So I said, she doesn't look her age. I said, yes, she has a very good makeup artist. So I hope when I land up in the hospital, somebody will tell this guy, look at the flat line when he goes, Mrs. Well, they say what goes around, I forgot this expression. Hello, whatever. Well, Dolly, why don't you play that beauty shop sequence? I know that's the, sorry, the question about my beauty shop, but my mom is in the beauty shop. It may not be interesting to give a little bit of a flair. Well, he looks for that. I want to show some essence here, so they don't think this is two boys in drag. I want you to know that there's human beings behind the facade, his and mine. But again, being Latin, I get more emotional, while the American boys, they keep their presence quieter. I can't, you know. So that's the crazy coochie coochie. You find it? Oh, no, what's the scene of the song in Wild? You fill my heart with very special things. You got it? With angel songs, with wild imaginings. You feel my
heart. If you want to look terrific in a hurry, what's your first stop? It's the beauty salon, right? Well, tonight Dan Weiss visits a very special salon that takes you, not only makes you look good, but it turns you into a star.
Hi, I'm Dan Weiss on Consumer Affairs. When you think of the fashion centers of San Francisco, you think of Maiden Lane, Union Street, Nob Hill. But some of the biggest names in show business are finding their way to Potrero Hill, to the address of 18th and Kansas, where they find one of the most unusual hair salons on the West Coast.
This hairstylist, alias Ari Garcia, is in love with old Hollywood, and it shows in his salon. It's a living monument to the old stars, and to one star in particular. His shop is the San Francisco chapter of the London-based Judy Garland Fan Club, and Ari's customers are as much in love with the stars as he is. In fact, the reason they come to him is to, in their own way, look like the stars they worship.
I'll tell the truth, I was a chestnut brown with gray streaks. And I just, first I tried sherry colored, like Susan Hayward, you know, just beautiful soft sherry. And I wore that for a few months. And then I just decided I wanted to be a blonde. And now I'm wearing a Marilyn Monroe hairdo.
This is the Gene Simmons haircut. Of course, Gene Simmons has more different hair tools, but this is one of the more popular she has worn, which is very cute and short for the summertime especially, and somebody who's got a very busy cooking schedule like you do. That way you won't get molested at your work.
But Hollywood stars are more than a fantasy to Harry. Some of the biggest names in show business have graced his shop and used his talents, preferring his quaint Potrero Hill shop to the pretentiousness of some of the larger salons. But whether you're an actual star or only dream about it, you're treated as well. In fact, Ari will even play the records or even show the movies of your favorite stars. But there's no doubt that Judy Garland reigns over the store. Ari knew her, did her hair, and now owns some of her priceless personal belongings. And it's Judy's philosophy that runs the salon.
Forget your troubles, come on, get happy. You better chase all your cares away. Shout hallelujah, come on, get happy. Get ready for the judgment day.
What a happy future lies ahead. Thank you, Bluebird. Happy, happy Bluebird, Mr. Bluebird. Hello!
So if you love glamour, love the stars, or if you just want a good time, women or men alike can feel like a star in the most unusual salon in the city.
They are all beautifully done. Hope you like it.
Well, you know, even Ari makes a mistake once in a while. Taylor hairstyle, and I ended up with Elizabeth Taylor. Well, maybe I'll grow to like it. Look out, Richard Burton. I'm Dan Weiss for Saturday Night.
Sweetie. The batteries die. We went to a shop and we have no lights. pay the bills? Oh my God. Oh.
See? No. Yes.
I don't know what I'm doing.
Here we go.
Oh, sit down, darling. Now. Let me go back to him. What were your feelings about performing as a woman? Was it just a job, or did you really enjoy the dressing up aspect?
Well, I enjoy dressing up because it's glamorous, you know, but when I was with the Jewel Box Review, they wanted me to not reveal that I was a guy. The MC of the show was a male impersonator. We had many that I worked with, Tommy Williams, Mickey Mercer, Joe Vaughn, who you saw in the film clip, Stormy DeLavier, and several, and I would do duets with them in the finale, is there something like that. But they didn't want me to talk because they wanted me to keep them guessing, you know, not because I sang in the soprano voice and look real. I padded here and there, you know, but nature is forgotten, we stuff the cotton, you know. But otherwise, you know, had the right pads, and they said, well, don't say anything, you know, don't talk at all. So that, and the only girl was the MC, who was the male impersonator in the show, Bill 25 Men and a Girl. But I really enjoyed it. It was glamorous, and I had fun.
And the lady MC at Duo Box, she used to impersonate Johnny Mathis, right?
So, yes.
Yes. Very well too. Let's see. Let's go to this. I don't want to wear contact lenses. What was there anyone who influenced you or whom you idolized?
Well, mm-hmm.
Somebody who influenced you? Didn't you say you have a drag mother? That famous impersonator, Harvey Lee?
Yes. When I was living in Southern California, in Orange County, there was a club in Long Beach called the Blue Turban. Now, it was, they had impersonation shows, and I had a regular job. I worked for a newspaper, the Santa Ana Register, for a number of years. And we would go over there on the weekends. They had shows on Sunday. And catch a show, and was MC'd by Tony Midnight, and Harvey Lee was one of the featured performers. Now Harvey Lee was very immaculate, beautiful. She was she looked like Alice Faye, or kind of a touch of Jean Harlow, that type, because Harvey came along much earlier, in the 30s, I believe, because it's like the, you know, Finocchio's didn't really start to what, 1938? And then, of course, the Jewel Box was...
I wasn't born yet.
No, you were too young.
That was my familia, was right there, 100 years old. No.
Yeah. Time marches on.
Remember Carol Wallace, our MC? This was funny. Gorgeous Carol Wallace. When he was 20, he used a technique. He would say to people, I have been in show business for 35 years, we was only about 20. So people would say, how can that flawless face be 35 years old? But now, time passes by, and Carol Wallace is working at Finocchio's, and Russell Reed, which I'll speak about him in my show this September, he says, he wanted to be very elegant to me. He would say, Mr. De Alba, as he is Russell. Carol Wallace was a beauty in her time. He was 300 pounds, Russell Reed. Carol Wallace was a beauty in her time, and she used to tell people, I'm older than she was. But now, when Carol Wallace, who is old, says to people, I have been in show business for 50 years, he looks it. I said, but don't you tell him that? So he heard that, so Carol Wallace got a facelift. I said, why you should do a facelift? Because he wore this wig that was a glue on here, here, and here. So he would pick up, and he looked perfect. But then when he took the wig off, the face came down, so he called to Russell Reed. He had a Dominica, he wants to look pretty as a boy, Russell. Oh my God. So many stories, so little time. I want to tell these people so they know about these wonderful kids. Or when I do a costume change, I want them to play a movie that he was part of called Golden Gate Murders. And after the movie flip, he'll tell you the story. Pretty girl. I said, you should come when you're alive so we can give you a tribute here. Oh yes, I will. I said, when? So anyway, so Jeannie, I don't know why I was riding in the car with her. She says, David, I don't know why you gave Lavern such a long introduction.
I'll be right back. I want to talk to Willie. You'll be all right. Just stay here.
Sorry, David. You can't just stand here. But we're in a minute. The show's about to begin. But I can.
Why I forget, so Jeannie, Renee, Carl's wife, she says, you gave Lavern an introduction that went on and on. I said, well, honey, he made a movie, and Renee's darling, but he hasn't made a movie. Yes, but she loved her husband. My husband is an international dancing star. So I said, okay, so next day, I gave Renee a long introduction, and then she says, oh, that was too long, make a shorter next time. I said, what's wrong with these people? Lavern, tell the story, please, or I change about
okay, yes.
About this movie. He hates the balding spot. Tell him. He's not bald. Tell him.
When I was appearing at Finocchio's, of course, there was different people from the studios came in and were eyeing me to do something in a film, you know, because I was the glamorous Lavern at Finocchio's, and we had talent scouts and many film stars came up to see us. I remember Betty Davis came up, and we have a picture with her. Debbie Reynolds, who's still with us, and many stars, many. But they made me an offer to see if I wanted to appear in this film to play a nightclub singer who turned out to be a guy. So I thought about it, and I thought, well, maybe it'd be fun to do, you know. I had strictly done clubs, but I had done a few television appearances, like as in interview shows, not always in drag or in female attire. I would do things like the anniversary game show with Alba and Paul. You know who's married to Suzanne Summers? She was in the audience, I think, when I did that. That was way back, so she must have been about 19. But anyway, I did that, and I did several guest spots and things. So I thought I would give it a shot. And so I was, they sent me the script and a date that I was to be there. And so I had to get permission to take off to go do the film. And, you know, do wardrobe and all of that. So it was shot, I think, in October of whatever year it was. I think it was 78. But anyway, we had shot the scene, and they did several retakes. And so when it came to that end shot where I was to pull the wig, with Susanna York, who was a delight, a very nice lady. And I didn't have any scenes with David Jansen, who was the star, of course. And I pulled the wig, and I didn't have the ball thing. I just had my own short hair underneath. And so I thought, well, you know, that's what they're going to use. But a few weeks or days, I don't know, it was a couple of weeks later, they called me back for retakes. And they said that it was not shocking enough, and it needed something to kind of help that scene. So I had to go through the process of putting a bald head thing, whatever they did, the makeup artist did on me. So I never had bald hair, that's my own. And so that's how it came out. And but it worked out fine. And I enjoyed doing it. It was fun. It's playing in Europe now, as Ricky Renee, my dear friend Tony, he saw it on European television just not long ago.
Things always in life is a valley of tears. I'm told we ran out of our time. There's so much we are supposed to do, another song and more clips, but there's other shows that follow us. So I'm going to your permission to this. And we had to do a comeback performance because, you know, I cannot condense this show so short. We wanted to do a song, and I was going to do this here. I'll do this for you together. I am what I am. I am my own special creation. So come, take a look. Give me the hook or the ovation. It's my world. And it's my world. Smile though your heart is aching. Smile even though it's breaking. When there's a cloud in the sky, you'll get by. If you smile through your fear and sorrow, smile and maybe tomorrow the sun will come shining through for you. Light up your face with gladness. Hide every trace of sadness, although a tear may be ever so near. That's the time you must keep on trying. Smile, what's the use of crying? You'll find that life is still worthwhile if you just smile.
Yeah. So are you still filming?
Yeah, smile.
Here you go. DVDs.
Oh, okay.
All set and ready to go.
All right.
Have a nice night.
Thank you.
Okay.
What's that? Yeah. Yeah, I've got to go over to the rehearsal room. I've got like 40 people.